So everybody, I've always wanted to do a chat from the high bridge here, and it's always been kind of windy. It's not very windy today, and I found the spot where the camera feels pretty safe, like it's not going to fall off into the river, the mighty Chippewa down below. So we're looking toward downtown from here, so to the south, on this Ash Wednesday 2024. So happy Ash Wednesday. I have to admit, I don't want to start out Lent by lying. I mean, I had this ash mark on my head all day from Pat, the 7 o'clock mass today. It's about 4 o'clock now, so. And it had worn off, but I thought, well, it's Ash Wednesday. I'd like to have that as something that's seen. So anyway, I re-ashed myself before I came over, and I was pretty sloppy, I guess. So Ash Wednesday. I hope you got a chance to pray today. Go to your inner room, as the gospel story says today, and pray to your Father in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will repay you. It's a call to interiority, is the fancy word I learned in seminary. The interior life. And more than that, you know, I asked the kids today, I said, what does it mean to turn to God with all your heart at the school service for the ashing? And one student said, pray. But almost all the other ones just talked about acts of kindness toward, you know, if someone's sad, go sit with them, which is great. It's real incarnational spirituality that our St. James school students have. You know, we can turn to God with all our heart by loving our neighbor. So I was impressed. Then I did encourage them, though, to pray and from their heart. I said, if you're going to turn to God with all your heart and pray today, how would you pray? And they're learning prayers. So one said I'd do the Apostles' Creed. One said I would do the Act of Contrition. One said the Our Father. You can never beat that, right? But I was trying to push them to maybe go to your inner room, as to kind of be alone with God and just talk from your heart a little bit. And I was surprised that they, maybe it's just too personal of a question, you know, what would you say to God? So I said, well, I'll try to lead by example. And so I said a little prayer to God myself, how I might pray. So anyway, it's good. They're always great to pray with. We've got a couple of people. Speaking of ashes, it comes up. I thought of it during the alms collection, because it always comes up as a question on Ash Wednesday. Hi, guys.
Hey.
You'll say, well, if it says in the gospel that we read every Ash Wednesday, don't pray so everybody can see you, but pray to your Father in secret. And then why do we wear these crosses down the day? Maybe we should wipe them off. In fact, I usually tell a story, I'm sure I have on the chat, when I was in fourth grade, Johnny Nepple's mom picked us up after school, and we had our ashes, and I was kind of proud of my ashes. I think Johnny was too. And we were going to go get him a bicycle at Bueller's bike shop. So I remember it really clearly. And his mom said, it was a great, great woman. She gave a life to working with people with special needs, and just a good, good person. And anyway, she said, Johnny, wipe those ashes off your head. We don't want to be showing off to everybody. So that was maybe in the spirit of the gospel today, but I thought, I've always thought about that. So why would we? Why would we? I don't know that we encourage people to keep the ashes on their heads. I think it's okay either way. It's probably bad if you're ashamed and you wipe it off. if you're afraid to give witness, it's probably bad if you keep it on so you can say, hey, look at me, aren't I spiritual? You know, so a lot of it's the motive. It's not the action that is the judge of right or wrong. But there are other examples. So I think, is it Friday's first reading, or tomorrow's or next week? But Nineveh, the people, Prophet Jonah, the people of Nineveh, they covered themselves in sackcloth and ashes. The whole society did, to show God that they were sorry for their sins. And I think there's a lot of power in that communal witness, you know? And so that's how I see. We have our ashes on our heads, and it's that biblical witness. Like, I am part of a humanity that needs to repent and follow more closely the rule of God and to love our neighbor and to love God. And it's not to show off. It's just to really be a, kind of a humble communal statement of our life together as loved sinners. As Pope Francis likes to say, and the Jesuit St. Ignatius, we're loved sinners. But then I was thinking as we... I like on Ash Wednesday, and so far I've remembered every Mass, sometimes I forget, is to do an alms collection, because that's one of the great... So fasting, I can't, you know, we can't... That's sort of up to you if you want to fast. I always have to look up the rule again. You want to know what the rule is? I'll tell you. It's a fast is minimally... You can have one regular meal and then two other meals, the sum total of which should not be greater than one meal, or should be less than one meal. If that makes sense. So you can have like, you can basically, it says you can sit down and eat three times, one regular meal, and the two other ones, when you add them together, it should be still less than one big meal. Anyway, if you can eat less and let that draw you into your humanity a little bit. I was just reminded again, I eat so I can survive when I'm hungry, and I forget about that. I think I eat because it feels good, you know. So it's good to get back in that basic touch. And then, of course, people that go hungry, right, to be in solidarity with that. So then the alm, so that's up to you, but we mark ourselves together. So that's the kind of the prayer part. We gather, and then it's up to you if you can pray to your Father in secret and go to your inner room. But then the almsgiving, I like to plug, this year we took our alms collection. Half is going to go to the Eau Claire Free Medical Clinic. We figured with the healthcare problems and in our community, the closing of the clinics and Sacred Heart St. Joseph Hospital, that there might be a really good charity to give to, the Eau Claire Free Clinic. And then the other half would go to Bethlehem, where we raised funds in November to send over to the people in the West Bank there during this war, and how shut down it is economically, and they have this ministry to people with intellectual disabilities. So we will send that. And also, by the way, I ordered some more olive oil, and they're selling Easter gifts. I'm not sure, I didn't order that many because I don't, you know how many people want them, but they're really, you know, those little wool sheep that we always sold. So they have those things without the, they're not sheep though, they're just wool balls, and then they color them real brilliant colors, and guess what they are? They're Easter eggs. And one of them is painted like a little, or it's decorated like a hen. So it's like a hen and her eggs. So got that to look forward to, but olive oil too. Anyway, so it says, you know, when you give alms, don't do it publicly. Don't let your right hand know what your left hand's doing. And so here we were taking an alms collection. I thought, well, I wonder how many people are uncomfortable with that, especially maybe people that, fewer people carry cash with them now and everything. So I hope it wasn't awkward, but in the end, I just think it's too good a cause not to do. And it says that it's one of the big Lenten disciplines is giving alms money to the poor. So just to do that communally again. But I get why people might think that's a little contradictory to the story we just heard in the gospel. I just bought this years ago, but I just brought this is what I meant to say. We're not actually going to hear this story, right? So Satan is like that little beast down there. And he's saying to Jesus, what? If you're the Son of God, turn this stone into bread. Son of God's don't go hungry. Sons of God don't go hungry. You know, use your powers and fill yourself. And Jesus here has the courage to stay empty, to remain in deprivation, brings him into solidarity with us, tests his own humanity, strengthens him for his mission ahead. And so I like this image, thought I'd show you that on this day when perhaps you're feeling deprived of food. Okay, so let's see. What else do I got here? I got my purple hat on, right? Should we do some parish news? Why not? Pool tournament. Okay, usually it's the Sunday before Super Bowl. This time it'll be the Sunday after Super Bowl. 1 o'clock till 3 o'clock in the parish pool hall. You didn't know we had a parish pool hall, did you? It's a room with plenty of cue space. And Donovan Molitor got us some new cues, and he refelted that table about 6 years ago. So I'm real grateful to him. And so hopefully we get some people. to come and have a kind of a round robin tournament. All skill levels are welcome, so I'll announce it at the masses too. Speaking of Super Bowl, Ginny, it was interesting. Ginny's grandson, Ben Bartsch, played in the Super Bowl. He was an offensive line on special teams. I saw him when they're setting up for field goals and all. And, well, it was a sad result for 49er fans and 49er grandmothers. And I just talked to her real briefly. She was decorating the church. I was doing other stuff. And but she said, boy, you want to feel sadness. That was just walking into that reception. So they had a reception for players and their families after the game. And everyone was just so deflated and sad. And you build up to that level of competition, and then it all comes down to this one game, right? And from a distance, you can say, well, you know, they made it to the Super Bowl. Isn't that great? But, you know, they have all these things and incentives. You'd want to, if you win, you get a Super Bowl ring, and you just, you'd be a champion, you know. So I can see that. For sure. And what was really touching was she said that her grandson then just came up to everybody in the family and just like apologized profusely. I'm so sorry. I hope, Jenny, that's not a personal information. I thought it was a touching story, so I thought I'd share it. But yeah, and that, remember the wild world of sports, the thrill of victory and the agony of defeat. So I guess she experienced that agony of defeat, and certainly her grandson did. So, Super Bowl. Also a Super Bowl. I was with my mom. I didn't know if she would like it or not, but she always liked pizza back in the day. As my older brother was remembering, when Dad would go away for a business thing and he wasn't home for dinner, then we'd get pizza because Dad didn't like pizza. And Mom and the rest of us did. So anyway, I thought you'd like it, and I got there just 15 minutes before a regular meal, and I had this, there's a nice pizzeria in Wausau called Ropa's. I really thought it was good. Sausage, all mom's favorite, sausage, onion, green pepper, and mushroom, and a thin crust, and anyway, she scarfed it up with me. She didn't eat that much, she has a smaller appetite, but she enjoyed it. It was good. Got some Diet Cokes, so... But I watched, I don't know if you saw, but there were a lot of people who are kind of buzzing a little bit about the Christian commercials that were on there. There's one. Hi. There's one called He Gets Us, right? And I've always liked the commercials. They've always seemed kind of interesting to me and good message. And this one, it was like a whole minute long of people of very diverse backgrounds. And one person in the scene would be washing the feet of another person. Now, if you're not that keyed into Holy Week liturgies, you might be like, what's going on? Why are people washing each other's feet? But I trust most of you at St. James would know what's going on there. And so at the Last Supper, knowing he had come from God and was going to God, Jesus rose from the table, wrapped a towel around his waist, filled a basin with water, and began to wash his disciples' feet. When he was done, after many objections, and when he was done, he said, so as I have done, you must also do. You refer to me as Master and Lord, and so I am. And if I, Master and Lord, wash your feet, you must wash one another's feet. So anyway, I just thought it was great, all these different things. So I read a news article about it, and I'm curious. I'm not sure. It costs a lot of money, obviously, to have a commercial on the Super Bowl. So they're funded. It looks like they've changed people that fund them. I went to the website. It says it's very public. You go to he'sforus.com. I thought it was heforus.org, but I went to he'sforus.com, and that was their website. And I don't know. Everything I read on the website I thought was really good, you know. And I guess it got some criticism from some people that it seemed like kind of a woke commercial because it had so much diversity and different types of people helping each other, washing each other's feet. It's a pretty central conviction of mine that is what Jesus was about, really reaching out and trying to include those who felt, who others tried to exclude, like the Pharisees and all that. He eats with sinners, you know, they got so mad he would eat with sinners, people that were considered unclean or tax collectors. And Jesus went there, you know, he had this radical table fellowship where he'd eat with anybody, you know. So And that seemed to be what they were emphasizing. And I wrote a little bit about it. In the article, it said that some people, one of the most common questions they get on their website is how they stand on the wedge issues. So what do you think about people who are gay, or people who are trans? And they said on their website, let's just be clear. Jesus loves gay people. Jesus loves trans people. No matter who you are invited to explore the story of Jesus and consider what it means for your life. I don't know how you can argue with that. I mean, Jesus loves everybody. No matter who you are invited to explore the story of Jesus and continue what it means for your, and consider what it means for your life. So I didn't get real deep into the website, but you click links. And so I think that'd be pretty decent. And I thought this was pretty deep. It said, the more ideologically defensive we become, it's about, you know, differences and political differences, the more we are willing to sacrifice things like kindness, patience, and the respect and dignity of others for the sake of victory. And so that's part of the motivation. And I thought, well, that's pretty good motivation. They see all this division. They see just basic Christian kindness and love being sacrificed for the sake of being right on different issues and excluding people. And I thought, well, I think they're right about that. So could do a lot of good. At the end of the washing feet video, it says, Jesus didn't teach hate. Came up on word. Jesus didn't teach hate. He washed feet. So leave that for you to consider. But I figured a lot of people saw the commercial. Maybe you were wondering about it. I heard there was also, I did not see it. I don't know when it was on because I pretty much watched the Super Bowl. But a lot of parishioners I know and people have on their phones and tablets the Hallo app, H-A-L-L-O-W, like Hallo be thy name. It's hallowed be thy name. So drop the E-D and Hallo. And you know, there's celebrities on it, and they talk about ways to pray. I haven't done it yet, but I have no reason to think it's anything other than a positive thing in the world. So if you want a little, maybe for Lent, explore the Hallo app. Maybe you want to look at the He's For Us website. The other website that I always think is so good, there's a couple of them, is BustedHalo.com. The Paulists have that website, especially for young adults. And another one is IgnatianSpirituality.com. IgnatianSpirituality.com. So, be good. We might get back to some Ignatian stuff before we go on. Let's see. Okay. Speaking of Hallo app, one of the celebrities on the Hallo app is Jonathan Rumi, who plays Jesus in The Chosen. We are going to have, I'm getting some positive buzz about it already, so maybe we'll have a big crowd. On our big screen in the gathering space, we can project... It worked last time for the Parish movie night, so hopefully it'll work for this. Anything that I can have on my phone or tablet, I can plug into this projector and then it shows. So, it'll be season 2, episode 1 of The Chosen. You've heard me talk about it, read about it, maybe you've not seen it, maybe you have. And why I choose that one is it's the first one I saw and it got me. And it's about St. James the Greater. He's sort of a main player in that episode. So I thought, what a perfect episode to show to the parish, right? So that'll be after Mass and after some hospitality time. So like 6:10, 6:15, Saturday, March 2nd. This weekend is just full, chock full of stuff. I felt bad. I have a friend I invited over for a concert. And it's like, well, you're not even going to be able to do anything other than the concert. Because there's after Mass we have things and the parish pool tournament. But anyway, so some weekends are just like that. So... there's a chili feed after Mass Saturday, just Saturday. It'll help fund the service trip down to over to Montana, which I think I can go. I got Father Shevs to sub. He's free. He's going to come. He's going to take that weekend when the service trip is for us at St. James. So I'm going to maybe get my a ticket and go out midweek and join them. So that's anyway, that's good. That's to help them. And then after every Mass this weekend... we'll gather in church, I believe, and have a listening session. So you got to experience, if you came to Mass at St. James, having the altar closer to the pews. Positive difference, negative difference, preference, why, thoughts. And we're happy to hear it. And I think maybe as it was initially presented, it struck some people like, this is what's going to happen and here's why. And not at all. That's why we set up the mock altar, the temperate mock altar, you know, a makeshift altar. And so we could get a feel for it, and not just you, but for myself as well. And so we'll see what people say. And we couldn't do a makeshift choir space, but one of the big issues is where the choir could go, other than right next to the altar, you know. So we'll talk about all that at all the masses. So please come and come, please, with a spirit of charity, and like you have something important to share, and that everyone else has something important to share. So come with your voice as well as your ears, right? And an open heart. Good. It can kind of test the maturity of a parish, how we deal with these issues. And I'm not always the greatest at potentially conflictual things, but together we get through it pretty well, I think. So that's this weekend. Healing Seminary. What does that mean? Healing Seminar. Okay, so not this weekend, but it's already next weekend. So we will have our parish mission. Father Karate's coming. He'll be talking about following Jesus, the issues of discipleship. It's always a great topic. He has a lot to share. We got a couple likes when it was announced on our Facebook page that he was coming to be with us. He'll preach all the weekends. He will give talks Sunday night, Monday night, Tuesday night. Each of those talks will be preceded by a soup and bread kind of dinner. And Monday at noon, we'll have kind of a summary presentation. So he's going to work hard for us, and I hope you can make it. Or, if you'd prefer, and I'm very open to this, so obviously the city's been under a lot of stress with the closing of the big hospital here, the smaller hospital in Chippewa Falls, Purveya Clinics, a lot of people losing their jobs, scrambling to find new jobs, a lot of patients, of doctors trying to figure out how they're going to get their health cared for, who their doctors will be, where they can go. It's a big deal. And our prayers continue as people try to hash out what can be saved. It's a good time to pray, you know. And so there's going to be, unfortunately, it's the same time as our parish mission. So Sunday night, 6:30 to 8 p.m., so a little later than our mission starts, on Sunday night and Monday night. We also have Tuesday night. So you could come to the Monday noon at St. James and Tuesday evening, and you could still go to both of these talks. But I'll just read the bulletin. This will be in the bulletin too, but Hope and Healing Retreat. The Eau Claire and Chippewa Falls Catholic Parishes invite you to a two-evening spiritual retreat to find hope and healing from stress and trauma. This retreat is being offered as a caring response to those who may feel shocked, outraged, saddened, uneasy, or numb in response to the decision to close HSHS Sacred Heart and St. Joseph Hospitals and Purveya Clinics. The retreat will also be meaningful for those experiencing stress or trauma from other causes. We'll explore together the human experience of stress and trauma, where people tend to get stuck, and how to find a path forward. Father Derek Sikowski, former pastor of St. Mary's and St. Raymond's, will be the presenter. He has extensive experience and certification in trauma-informed healing and intervention. And those meetings will be at 6:30 to 8, the 25th and 26th, Sunday night, Monday night, at St. Olaf Church. Okay, so please, I mean, don't have any, if that's where your heart's at and that's what's going on in your life, and you want to choose that over our parish mission, please do it. We're richly blessed those days with great opportunities for spiritual growth. What else we got here? On the 29th, Leap Day. You don't know what to do with an extra day? Well, come to St. James School for a slice of pizza. This is really for families with elementary age children. And we're going to have an author at St. James School, but to open it up to all other parents, families, public schools, other Catholic schools who might want to come. They're going to gather at 5, you can get a slice of pizza, and then at 5:30, hear from this author of children's books. And Danielle, our principal, has met him and heard his presentations, and they've been excellent, right? So the sound of, we understand people have been hearing, having our speakers that go to the back half of church. We have some speakers halfway in church have been inconsistent apparently, and we're having someone come to hopefully take care of that problem on Friday. So hopefully sound might never be perfect, but we certainly don't want it to be a frustrating experience every time you come to church if you can't hear. One option would be to sit closer, by the way. OCIA, our Lent starts, a kind of an intense period for our OCIA candidates, Caitlin, Susan, Michael, Brad, Craig, and they're all going to head down with Patrice and Steve to the cathedral on Sunday for the rite of election. Our Saturdays continue. It was a small group, but I guess it was quality. I'll be joining them for the rest of the Saturdays. Jesus and the Eucharist every Saturday of Lent, 10 a.m. to 12 a.m. in the gathering space. One day we might have to shift because there's like a quilter group or somebody that laid claim to that space first. So I just kind of want to share. I was going to maybe preach this weekend, but I went in another direction. I mean, this Ash Wednesday. So I went to the to Wausau, was it Monday a week ago? And I thought, well, I should get a sub because then I can digest a little bit. And by the time I get back home, I'll be able to do some exercise and I won't have my stomach full. So, and there was a sub place I'd never seen before. It was right there near where I wanted to get some gas. And so I go and it's packed. And I think, well, and I walk in and I talk to someone. I go, where do you order? Is this the line to order? And people were very helpful because it was a little chaotic. And found out what it was. It was the grand opening. It was the first night. But no free sandwiches were offered that I could tell. And anyway, so I got to the kiosk and I ordered kind of right away. But then I realized I would have to wait a long time because everybody was there. They'd all ordered. They're all waiting, right? And it was really a diverse crowd. And one of the guys that I walked by, he was sitting down, and he was just so different from me. I was just curious, I guess. And my look lingered a little longer on his face than probably I should have. And he looked back at me, he noticed that I was looking at him. So then I felt awkward, like, why was I looking at him for more than a half second, you know? And we just continued on with our lives. His girlfriend or wife was with him. And then I ordered and I'm waiting and someone else had their sandwich there in her hand. I go, it looks like you got your order. You're still waiting, huh? And she goes, yeah, they messed up my order and they forgot to put a sandwich in. So I'm waiting for their sandwich and I've already been waiting 15 minutes. And I'm like, oh, what a bad break, you know? But she had it. She was smiling. She was kind of happy. It was great. Then someone walked in, older woman, and she had kind of longer hairs coming off her chin. She was wearing bedroom slippers and kind of I don't know how to describe the coat. It looked kind of like a woolly mammoth coat, you know, but kind of old and kind of tattered. And so she looked like a poor person. And she was there and she, I don't know if she came to get her name called or something, but she got a sandwich and then she paused and she reached in her pocket and she stuck a dollar bill in the tip jar, which I thought, wow, that's awesome. You know, someone maybe doesn't have that much to share, like the widows might, though I was judging on appearances, I guess. And then this guy behind me came up and we're kind of sharing the menu a little bit. And I forgot the main point. So I thought, well, even if I have to wait for an hour, I have my phone. I can catch up on the news and everything, right? Well, guess what? I reached in my pocket, my phone, I left in the car kind of far away. So I thought, well, I can live without my phone, can I, you know? And I'm trying to have the spirit of my mother and I'm trying to talk with people around me. And it's just kind of interesting. We're talking about the weight and people are positive. And then that guy that I was different from me, you know, he his girlfriend got up and brought their food and he, it looked like cheese curds. I looked at him and I just blurted out because I was in this be like my mom, talk to people mode. I said, are those cheese curds? And he said, just looked at me, he goes, yeah. You want one? I said, I kind of do. And he said, yeah, sure. And so I took one. I said, oh, that's good. That's really good. And And then he just kind of made this gesture, just like Jesus, I think. He just kind of left those hands like, you want another one? You want my sandwich? I'll share it with you, you know? And I thought, wow. And all this kind of experience of all these things that I was noticing. Some other guy walked in, put a tenner in the tip jar, and you know, after he had to wait a long, long time. There's just a lot of waiting and a lot of people that were different and a lot of charity and conversations. And finally, I got mine after really about 50 minutes, 45, 50 minutes. I got my sandwich, and here's the kicker. The sandwich was terrible, but it's my fault. I ordered the wrong thing, just vegetables, no dressing. But anyway, either way out, I turned around to that guy, and I just, with his girlfriend there, and I just said, you know, I know it's kind of a small thing, but I really appreciate that you shared that cheese curd with me, you know, and he just kind of smiled, and his girlfriend just kind of smiled, and like, wordlessly said, yeah, I got a good guy, don't I? You know, indeed. But what I like about that for Lent was sometimes you give up something, like maybe you give up your cell phone for a time, like I did for that hour, but it can open up other opportunities. So I hope that's true for you in Lent, with some of your Lenten disciplines. Bye now. God bless you.